Hi everybody, and welcome back to Lecture 2, The Manufacturing Process. We're now at the third part of our lecture, which is process variations. So, as we saw up till now, there are many different steps in the manufacturing process, and these steps are very accurate. We're dealing with atoms, we're dealing with nanometers, we're dealing with very small things, and obviously when there's a small, slight, tiny difference between one process step and the other process step or how it's done, we're going to have variation in how our manufactured features come out. So there are many different levels of which we're going to differentiate between process variations. We'll start with a general kind of large scale type of a variation, and we can differentiate between what we call fab-to-fab variation, lot-to-lot, wafer-to-wafer, die-to-die, device-to-device, and there may be different subcategories. So starting like at the fab-to-fab variation, if we have a fab in one country, for example, in Taiwan, and another one, for example, in the US, there are gonna be different machines in the fab, there are gonna be different conditions around, and so a wafer that is produced or a die that is produced in one of the fabs may have some difference between a die that is produced in another fab, while two of those dies may have similar similar conditions or similar features. The same can be said about lot to lot. So usually we discuss 25 wafers is usually the what is called a lot, because there's a type of a box that 25 wafers can fit into, and that usually goes into a machine. So a lot of wafers is 25 wafers, and maybe there's some sort of different condition between one lot that goes into the process and the next lot. Obviously, there's wafer-to-wafer variation. So two dies that are on the same wafer may have some things in common that are different than two dies that are on a different wafer, and so that's wafer-to-wafer variation. And finally, die-to-die variation. Die-to-die variation is kind of the lowest level, which we're discussing about this type of a global type of a variation, and it can occur due to many things. For example, the position of the die on the wafer itself, or even on the mask. So if we have a wafer, and we have one die that's over at the side of the wafer and one die that's over at the middle, there may be differences between these dies just because of the distance they will be between, some sort of proximity effect where a certain process step is applied to them. Another thing is that, remember, we have our mask that we're projecting our photolithography with, and the mask is much smaller than the wafer itself, and then we have the step and scan, so maybe we project the mask here and here and here and so forth, and so there may be a difference between a die that's on the side over here of the mask and a die that's kind of on the middle of the mask. Okay, so that would be our die-to-die variation. However, there's also what we call device-to-device variation, and that's actual, if we take a specific die out of this entire wafer and we look at it, we will have a difference between a transistor that's over here and a transistor that's over there, and that's device-to-device variation. What are the types of things that cause variation? Well, there are process parameters that happen due to variation. So impurity concentrations, oxide thickness, diffusion depth, these are types of parameters that in the end are going to be affected by variation, and they're caused during deposition, diffusion steps, etc., ion implementation, of course, and they affect different parameters, but mainly VT, the threshold voltage of the transistors, and TOX, the thickness of the gate oxide, are the main things that are affected by them. The other thing that is often affected by process variation are the device dimensions. So the lengths and the widths of gates, metals, etc., are going to change because of variation between process steps, and that's mainly due to photolithographic limitations, and differences between one thing that we photographed and the next. Here's a kind of an older graph that shows this type of variation. So if we take two different parameters, one is the effective length of the transistor, and the other one is the threshold voltage of the transistors in an adder circuit, we can see that we have an effect due to the variation in the length of the transistors. We're going to get a big scattering here of the actual delay that's going to happen in the overall circuit. And if we take a variation in the threshold voltage of the PMOSes over here, again, we're going to have a big scattering in the entire delay of the adder circuit. Okay, so this is going to affect us a lot as designers. We'll further dive into categorization of process variations, because we're not going to usually know which lot our die came from or so forth and so on. And we usually discuss two types of variation. One is random variation, which occurs without regards to the location and patterns of transistors within the chips. For example, random dopant fluctuation, which we discussed previously and we'll discuss on one of the next slides. Or systematic variation, which is truly related to the location and patterns. In fact, it's something that we can sometimes even measure. For example, the density of the layout in a certain area, the proximity to the edge of the well, the distance from the center of the wafer, as I showed before. These are types of things that are systematic, and they'll be similar to different features of the same die, of the same transistor on a certain layout and so forth. Okay. Usually we further change the categorization into two things: intra-die, or within-die variations. So these are variations between elements in the same chip, and we call this local variation. So that is, we have two transistors that are right next to each other. They may be even talking to each other. They're on the same die and so forth. But the VT of this and the VT of this may be different, and that we call local variation. Okay. Most of local variation is random. Some of it can be systematic. Okay, and the other one is the inter-die, the die-to-die variation. And that, again, is everything we basically discussed on the previous slide from fab level to die level. That means there are two different dies, and they may have been fabricated differently. They can be in the same, again, two dies on the same wafer, two dies in different wafers. It can be two dies in the same mask development, and they can be, again, two dies that are made in two different fabs, two different places around the world. And that we call global variation. Usually when we discuss global variation, we talk about some sort of a variation that affects all of the transistors or all of the metal layers or something that are on a certain die. So everything is moved or shifted the same on the circuit that we're simulating. But if we simulate across different manufacturing different dies, then we're going to have to shift everything accordingly. So I'm going to go into a few of these variations, and the first one is, of course, this random doping fluctuation, and it has been the most significant factor in variations of the threshold voltage, and it's because of the QI, the implant charge that we discussed previously, that goes into the channel. So you can see here these nice 3D plots that kind of show the density of the implants inside the channel, and here we see that you can see that there is not an infinite number of implants in here. You can maybe count them if you look at that with a type of a magnifying glass. And in fact, in older technologies, such as a 1 micron technology, there were thousands of dopants. It's not in the millions, it's in the thousands, something countable. But as we scaled, we put less implant dopants inside the channel. And in 32 nanometer technology, which is already quite an old technology today, there were already less than 100 dopants. In fact, this paper came out in 2008, so we're talking about many years ago already, and we already had less than 100 dopants. I'm talking about 100 atoms that go into a channel. So you can really count them, and that means that there's a lot of variation. If this is, again, in some sort of a statistical operation that we put it in. So we're shooting dopants at the channel over here with some sort of flux and for some sort of amount of time. And we know that statistically, 100 dopants, let's say, will be stuck in the channel. But what happens if 99 dopants are stuck in, or maybe 110 dopants are stuck in? We're going to have a real variation between our threshold voltage of our transistor. And that's a big problem. It's a huge variation. So RDF accounts for about 60% of the threshold variation of the transistors. In fact, in many of the recent processes, we've tried to go more intrinsic, have less of this implant inside the channel in order to limit the spread of the variation of the threshold, which really causes a lot of trouble. Another very important type of a variation is line edge roughness and line width roughness, or LER and LWR. So these cause changes in subthreshold current and threshold voltages, and they're basically a problem that's inherent to the scaling of the transistor. So if we look over here on the left, we see a picture of a line, say a polyline on a die, which is going to be the gate of the transistor. And we see that they're really nice. I mean, this is pretty straight, right? We get some pretty straight lines, but that when we're talking about such a small dimension, even these small shifts in the size of this, they're not very straight, right? When we look at the little curvature we have here in relation to the length of the transistor, it's actually pretty substantial. Here we can look over here at this little schematic here, and what we call line edge roughness is this curvature that we have over here. So this is the line edge roughness, and when we talk about line width roughness, we talk about the two sides of a feature and how at some points they're going to be closer together and at some points maybe they're going to be farther apart. And this causes variation. So the L over here and the L over here are not equal and they can in fact be substantially very different. And that causes a lot of variation of how fast the transistor, the electrons are going to pass the channel and so forth. So it actually causes what our threshold voltage is, what our speed is, and so forth. So RDF may nowadays even be the main cause of variation, especially in certain technologies such as gate all around transistors and so forth. Another effect that's more of a systematic effect is called the well proximity effect, or WPE. And you can see here in the little picture over here that we have our active areas where we're going to be making transistors, and we have our SDIs on the side, or our field oxides. And on top of it, we're going to have some photoresist that's going to block the implants from coming into the well when we're defining our wells over here. We're defining our wells, we're defining our transistors and whatever. Some of these ions are going to hit the photoresist and be deflected, and versus the ones over here that are probably going to come straight down and statistically stick into our into our silicon at the right hopefully at the right depth. But what's going to happen here is that depending on how far away we are from the edge of the well, we may have more or less dopants over here. And that is a well proximity effect. It's systematic. We can know statistically how many, how the distribution of the dopants is going to be different than over here. And therefore, one of the things that's often done is we have different types of dummy dummy poly gates and all kinds of DRC rules of how far we should be away from the edge of the wells, just in order to reduce the variation between a transistor that's over here versus a transistor that's over here. Okay, so that's a well proximity effect. Additional variations that we're going to run into, and again, pretty much every process step that I discussed before has some sort of source of variation, and there are many more process steps that I didn't discuss, but some important ones, gate dielectric variation. So we know that we're putting this very thin, maybe 1.5 nanometer or so gate oxide across the whole wafer. Obviously, some of them are going to be 1.51 and some of them are going to be 1.49 nanometers, and that's going to change, that's going to make a difference in the oxide thickness, affecting both the threshold voltage, the oxide capacitance, and so forth. There's going to be fixed charge that's going to be stuck in the oxide at all kinds of places. That's the Qox in the threshold voltage equation. So there's some sort of a probability that fixed charge or is going to be at some places across the wafer. And there's also going to be defects and traps, which are also going to affect the quality of the oxide and in the end, the quality of the transistor. CMP, chemical mechanical polishing variations. So we have a lot of different steps that use CMP after them. That's when we're going to be polishing again the wafer and making it very straight and equivalent across the whole die. There are going to be differences in between the CMP at different places. If our wafer wasn't exactly completely straight, it had a small amount of gradient, it's going to have different thickness of the previous layer at each place, and that's going to affect our STI, our metal gate height, our interlayer dielectric, the interconnect thickness, and so forth, and that's going to affect us as designers. We're going to have variation in strain, which we'll discuss later on in the course, variation in implants, and variations due to rapid thermal annealing, for example, how much diffusion we have, and so forth. So we're going to have variation again at pretty much every single step of the process that I discussed, and in the end, we have to model this, which I'll be discussing in the next lecture. So how are process variations going to impact us? As we learned previously, we have this voltage transfer curve, our VTC, and what we would be expecting is to have this nominal VTC, which is shown over here. but unfortunately, because of variation, our VTC is going to shift. So for example, if we had a very strong PMOS transistor and a very bad NMOS transistor in our type of inverter, right, what we're going to have is we're going to have this shift over to the right, and our VTC is going to be like this, which is going to change our basically our VM, our threshold of our switching threshold of our transistor, our noises and margins and so forth. And if we have a bad PMOS transistor and a good NMOS transistor, our threshold, our VTC is going to shift over here. And that's just looking at a VTC static curve. This is going to obviously have effect on every single one of our device parameters, such as the propagation delay, the power, and everything in our gate or in our circuit that we're going to be building out of these transistors that are not equivalent to each other. So we're going to get back to this in the next lecture when we discuss process corners and Monte Carlo simulations. But for now, just leave it at that, that process variations are going to affect us, as designers. And so we have to realize that they're there and know how to deal with them. So that's it for this section. And in the next section, we're going to discuss a number of manufacturing issues that occur due to process variation and due to the improvements in process that we've discussed throughout this lecture.